I'm going to read the word. Let's pray. Mighty God, your word says, in the beginning, the word already existed. The word was with God and the word was God. And so, Father, as we listen to the word today, I pray that you would open our ears to hear, open our minds to receive, open our spirits to be changed. Father God, I pray that you would speak through the messages today. Mighty God, we love you and we give honor to you as we read your word. Amen. Matthew 20, verse 1 to 16. Jesus is speaking. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing at the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon, and he did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing around all day doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When the evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired, and go on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came, and each received a denarius. So when the workers came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired last worked only an hour," they said, "and you made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the work in the heat all day." A-boo-boo-boo. Emphasis added. But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I'm generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last.
Yeah. Well, I'm excited that you're here this morning. We're kind of launching back into our series called Like Christ. We've been doing a very long chew into Matthew for about 2 years. We have been kind of going line upon line through the book of Matthew. I want to welcome everybody who's watching online here this morning as well. We're stoked that you've chosen to join us here this morning. Happy that you're checking us out. How many of you are still enjoying your Christmas presents? Some of you have forgotten all about them altogether. Okay. I'm pretty proud. It's only taken me 3 weeks to complete a puzzle that I got for Christmas. And I feel pretty good because on the box, it said 2 to 4 years. So I showed them. For New Year's, one of my resolutions was to get more in shape. So I'm trying a new exercise that I actually really like. They're called diddly squats. And I am good at them.
You test them at the office.
Ouch. Ooh. Ah. You can have that one back. Today, I'm excited that God has this message lined up, that this has this specific verse lined up. There's lots been going on in people's lives, and it's crazy that it landed this way. I love that God has a plan and a purpose, and we just sometimes need to get out of his way. I'm excited about what it is that he's going to speak here this morning. We've been looking at this series, or in this series called Like Christ, we've been looking at this idea of holiness, where holiness is this idea of being set apart for purpose. That's what the Hebrew word holy means, being set apart for purpose. And we've been learning about how to apply a holy attitude into our lives, a holy outlook, a holy lifestyle into our lives. And today we're going to continue this deep dive into holiness as we learn how to apply holiness into our work lives. Primarily, we're looking at the temptation of getting disgruntled. Anybody ever get disgruntled? Well, we just turn to somebody beside you and say, "Today I'm going to learn how to get gruntled." You didn't say it. Just turn to somebody else, look them in the eye and say, "Today, let's get gruntled." Even though the term has fallen out of use in the English language, to gruntle somebody, according to the dictionary, to gruntle someone is to put them into a good mood, to make them content and happy. Disgruntled is the opposite of that, where I choose personally to become discontent. I choose to become unhappy. I choose to look at things through a negative lens and have a bad attitude. You know, due to our selfish nature, we often choose being disgruntled in our lives over choosing to be content, which is what it is that God offers to us. That choosing joy is available to us at any given time if we want it. Here's something to remember, and to be honest, it applies to your relationships, it applies to your work life, it applies to your school life, it applies to your family life, your spiritual life. This, I'm saying off the top because before, you know, you doze off into whatever dreamland that I eventually put you into, I hope that you get this here. Being perpetually disgruntled will drain you of all of your joy, of all of your energy, and it will rob you of the good life that God has for you. Being disgruntled is a choice. We all know that it costs more energy to scowl and frown than it does to frown. Sorry, I'm going to say that again. I love being dyslexic. We all know that it costs more energy to scowl and frown than it does to smile. There, I spit it out. Turn to somebody beside you and smile. Yeah, I know some of you didn't. You didn't want to. I just would rather just be here scowling, wasting more energy because I'm on a diet. So I'm scowling because I'm burning calories more than smiling. That's your excuse. When we suddenly just even do something as mundane as put on a smile, we are choosing something different. We're choosing a different perspective, a positive outlook, a purpose to be involved in something different than the world has to offer. A life of contentment and joy is available at any given time. It is only a choice for believers. Let's get back to the parable that we read earlier. The owner decides to pay a denarius, right? A good day's wages back then, actually. A denarius was the amount that the Roman army would be paid for a single day. And what it is that the average regular worker would be paid for a single day. And yet, these guys are day workers. And to be honest, normally they would be paid less due to the fact that crooked business owners knew that these workers were desperate. And so they could get away with paying them less. And day workers, especially in poorer countries, they are among the hardest working people that you will ever see. They will bust their butts in the hopes of being taken on as a continuing worker. The owner decides to hire more workers throughout the day and decides to pay each of them an entire day's wages. And some people didn't like that and became disgruntled with what it is that they got, even though it was more than fair to be paid a single day's wages for the work that they did. The owner decides that he wants to hire more workers and pay them what it is that he wants to pay them. Some didn't like that and became disgruntled. And Jesus ends the parable by saying, "So the last will be first, and the first will be last." Now, one lesson in this parable that we can probably catch right off the top is about God's grace. Everyone who comes to him, as they did even some of people just a few moments ago, they come to him and they ask for help, and God's grace pours into their life where they get something that they don't deserve, right? And some people, all people who come to God, in fact, get the same eternal salvation that everybody else gets. That every believer receives the same salvation, the same promise of eternal life, whether they come to God early in their life or whether it's a last-minute decision. They get the exact same thing, everlasting life. But this morning, I want to focus on some other lessons that I think this points out to us, that we can learn in this parable that teach us something about the kind of attitude that we need to have in order to bring the kingdom into our workplace. In order to be just a little bit more like Christ, in order to be a people who are set apart, a people who look different from what it is that the world looks like. And if you make these adjustments, not only will it make a huge difference in your own life, but others will notice it as well. If you make these changes, your spouse will notice a difference in you. Your other employees that you work alongside, the other people who you work alongside will notice a difference inside of you. And so the first principle that I want us to understand that I believe that this parable is teaching us is if you get what you agreed to, accept it with gratitude. If you get what you agreed to, accept it with gratitude. In this parable, the workers who were hired agreed to work a full day for a full day's pay, one denarius. And at the end of the day, they got exactly what it is that they bargained for, a day's pay for a day's labor. And that should have been the end of it, right? But it wasn't in their eyes because some of the workers got a better deal than they did. Let me tell you something. No matter what you do, there will always be somebody who gets a better deal in your life. Someone who makes more money for what appears to be the same type of work, somebody whose working conditions seem to be a little more favorable to them than yours, someone whose job requirements are a little less demanding than yours, and on and on and on. And yet, being content and grateful is a choice that we are all called to make. Each of us has to watch our thinking. And when you start to feel like something is unfair, then a disgruntled attitude will begin to form inside of your life where you start to feel negative all the time. And these can lead to actions in your life. Our thinking controls our heart, and our heart controls our actions, right? It'll affect our decision-making. Time for public embarrassing time. Public confession time. When I left teaching and was first hired at Connect Church, the church decided to pay me what it is that I was making as a teacher. Less the benefits and the pension, because to be honest, we just couldn't afford it. We were smaller than about 100 people who were regularly giving, and it was a stretch just to hire me. It was a huge leap of faith by a group of faithful people. And a lot of people increased their offerings, and they did with less in their own lives in order to make sure that we were able to work for the church. And I was very grateful. And I, to be honest, I am still continue to be grateful for this church. We've since grown, and God is doing some really beautiful things in people's lives right now. And I'm embarrassed to say that a couple of years ago, for about a two-month stretch, I became disgruntled. I began to let myself begin to think disgruntled thoughts. This led to being discontent with my situation. And then I start finding details that supported my unhealthy thoughts, right? Start thinking, well, retirement, medical, teacher's got a raise. Did you get a raise? No. Oh, I want things. And then combine that with inflation and grocery cost and mortgage increases, and my thinking just tanked. I'm here to say it was not cool. Please forgive me. See, if we let our selfish thoughts take over, all of us can start to wonder and think, well, maybe there's something better out there. We start seeing the margin decrease and the budget to live increase. And if we let it, the external will begin to affect the internal. And this can lead to living in a disgruntled state of mind. Maybe I'd be better off at a different job. Maybe this, and maybe that. And in living in the maybe, we stop appreciating the what is. The blessings that we've already received. It's dumb. And for a while, I was dumb. Please forgive me. I was wrong. I'm still in process. If you decided to start coming to this church because the guy at the front has it all together, you need to find another church. I will disappoint you. I'm still in the process of being made holy. Anyways, grateful is a choice. I repented, and I went back to being grateful, and joy returned. And then the elders decided to hire Dono, our worship guy, who's been a real huge blessing. And then they decided to hire Alec, our youth and outreach guy, who also happens to be my son. And I get to work with my kid. What a gift. And now, as a bonus, the church is working towards getting a pension plan for us, which is huge. I'm grateful. As well, we're looking at expanding and eventually hiring an executive pastor to see the new vision that God has for us, a vision to not only bring the kingdom into Cranbrook, but into the Kootenays. There are all sorts of communities inside of the Kootenays that literally don't even have a single church. We have to do something about that. Man, I'm so freaking blessed. See, all of us need to remember that if you get what it is that you agreed to, be grateful. Choose contentment. Choose joy. Choose to eat from the tree of life. More on that in a little bit. But choose contentment. Then when anything more comes your way, what a bonus. Next principle. Focus on what you should be doing, not what others should be doing. Turn to somebody beside you and go, ooh. Some of you didn't want to ooh even because you don't like it. Focus on what you should be doing. The workers who were hired first, they became disgruntled because, as we've already seen, they weren't happy with the deal that the newer workers were given. Their unhappiness can be traced to a critical attitude towards their employer. They didn't like the way that he was running his business. They wanted to tell him what to do. They wanted to tell him who they should hire, and so on. They wanted to tell him how it is that he should use his money. They forgot a crucial truth that sometimes we as workers forget. The boss is the boss. He can spend money the way that he or she sees fit and can run their business the way that they want to. The employer is in charge. They're subject to God alone. They are subject to God. They have been placed in charge of God's business and will someday have to give an account for how it is that they ran it. Because like Shelby said, everything is God's. If you're an employee, I can guarantee this. From time to time, your boss will make decisions that you disagree with. They will hire people that you don't think should have been hired. They will make choices that you think are dumb. They will implement procedures that you think are nothing but a waste of time. So what? That's not your job. What's your job? Do your job. That's your job. Do it. Right? See, when we are eating of the tree of life and really connecting to God's love, remember he told us to abide in him. God is the tree. Jesus is the branches. We are the vine. We stay connected into him. When we eat of the tree of life, there is a connectedness and a oneness with him that keeps us focused on just him, honoring him, loving him. But every once in a while, we're tempted, like Adam and Eve, to go and eat from the tree of life. Or not from the tree of life, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Where we start to debate what is good and what is evil, what is right and what is wrong, what I should get versus what others have. And we live in this polarized world that we choose to eat from on a daily basis that does nothing but create disconnect and discontent in us. Anyone ever seen the movie Amadeus? It's an old movie. Amadeus, any of you old enough? Just us gray hairs. All right. Sorry if I just added you into the gray hairs. But I'm happy to be there. I've earned these. When this movie first came out, I absolutely loved it. The movie is about the story of Mozart. And it's narrated by a character by the name of Antonio Salieri, who is also a composer. And he really wanted to be the greatest composer that there was. And then along came this young upstart named Mozart. And instead of spending time with God and developing his relationship with God, Salieri spent most of his time railing at God for what it is that he chose to do through this young upstart named Mozart, right? And for bestowing such talent on Mozart, this person who was unholy and reckless. And as a result of taking Satan's bait, Salieri never composed any great music. He just spent his life becoming bitter over Mozart's talent. See, you can be focused on your job, or you can be focused on how those around you are doing their jobs, but you cannot be focused on both and still be effective and good at your job. Did that make sense? If you want to be effective in your work or in your ministry or whatever it is that you feel like God has called you to, where it is that he's placed you in this current season, get your eyes off other people. Stop criticizing those in leadership and start to focus on doing your job well, because that's honoring God. 3, let's go there. Don't begrudge another person's blessing. The workers who were hired first, they got a good deal, a solid deal that they agreed to. A day's pay for a day's labor. And the workers who were hired last, they got an incredible deal, right? Pay far beyond anything that they could have expected under normal circumstances. On this day, the owner decided to be generous beyond belief to some. And that happens sometimes. Someone gets a blessing, and you don't. Great. The temptation is to begin to compare when somebody else gets a windfall. Someone's on the receiving end of generosity and you're not. And when that happens, we tend to respond in the wrong way. What is it that we should do when somebody gets a windfall? Be glad for them. celebrate them, celebrate with them. Oh, that's awesome. So cool that this happened to you. And their blessing becomes then our blessing. Let me tell you something. Begrudging the blessings that others receive, it will not increase the number of blessings in your own life. Nor will it diminish their blessing in any way, shape, or form. All it does is make you miserable. So when the people around you get more than they deserve, be happy for them. Choose that. Now, so far we've looked at three very specific principles that we can learn from the workers, right, who were hired first. For the next principle, let's look at it through the eyes of the workers who were hired last. No matter what happens, position yourself for possibilities. No matter what happens, position yourself for possibilities. As I mentioned earlier, these were day laborers. They didn't have regular jobs. Each day they were dependent on somebody coming to them to hire them for work one day at a time. And in this parable, some of these men went to the marketplace early in the morning seeking employment, and they were not hired. What did they do? Did they say, "Ma, looks like I won't have any work today. I'm just going to go home and eat pitas." No. What did they do? They positioned themselves for possibilities by being faithful and waiting expectantly for what it is that could possibly come their way. They decided to wait in the marketplace with expectancy. Even though the owner of the vineyard came and said, "What are you doing standing around doing nothing?" Well, they weren't actually doing nothing. What were they doing? Being faithful to receive what it is that God might have for them by patiently waiting for God to move on their behalf and positioning themselves for what it is that he might do. These men knew that if they went home, they'd never get hired. But if they stayed in the marketplace, maybe, just maybe, somebody would offer them a job for the day. And even a few hours' pay was better than nothing at all. So they kept themselves positioned for possibilities. And what happened? They got more than they could have hoped for. A full day's pay for just a couple hours' work? Wow! They kept themselves positioned for possibilities. What could this mean for you? You know, maybe things aren't exactly where it is that you want them to be right now. Maybe for some of you, things aren't looking up. Maybe for some of you, things aren't looking good. Can I encourage you? Keep yourself positioned for God to use you. Keep yourself positioned for possibilities. If you give up and quit as soon as it looks like things aren't going to work out, that you're not going to get the breaks that you need, if you just give up and kind of like go watch Netflix all day, man, you're missing out on what it is that God might want to do. Instead, how can you be proactive and intentional and get yourself ready for what it is that God might want to do? Even when it's late in the day, for some of you, and it seems like everyone else is getting blessed, keep hopeful. Keep expectant of what it is that might come your way. God may bless you more than you possibly can even deserve. Here's my conclusion this morning. Jesus at the end of this said, "So, the last will be first, and the first will be last." See, heaven's value system, the kingdom's value system, is different from earth's value system. And those who are esteemed and respected in this world may be frowned upon by God. The opposite is also true. Those who are despised and rejected in this world, like the disciples were, may in fact be rewarded by God. We as believers, as leaders in God's kingdom, we will get scoffed at for being content when everybody else is disgruntled. We will get mocked when we overlook an injustice done to us because it's more important for us to keep the relationship and unity than it is for us to get what it is that I deserve. When I choose not to demand my rights, why? Because Jesus didn't demand his rights, and the early disciples didn't demand their rights, and instead they loved their enemies. Instead, they submitted to those around them. Instead, they made sure that they just, you know, sometimes turned the other cheek. Why? Because relationship and connection and unity is far more important than me getting what it is that I deserve. And you'll be scoffed at for that. You'll be honored by God for having a kingdom mindset. But the lesson is, don't get caught up in the world's way of doing things, of seeing things, of ranking things. It may look like a lack of fairness and justice, but it's often an opportunity to be more like Christ. And being more like Christ at work can be difficult. Holiness at work, in your job, or in your area of ministry, is expressed through this attitude of generosity towards the people around you at any given time, where you hope that they get what it is that you would have liked to have received. And you're always celebrating the generosity that's poured out on them. It's an attitude that says it's okay if God blesses you more than he blesses me, because he's already given me more in my life than I could have ever dreamed. He's already given more in my life. I've already received more grace from him than I've ever deserved. I've received more mercy than I ever could have possibly dreamed. Once you take your eyes off of everyone else and get focused on what it is that you're supposed to be doing, focusing on God and myself and our relationship and me honoring him, that's when you open the door to God's blessing in your life in a great way. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this message this morning, that you lined it up today. For some people, they needed to hear this today. And I thank you, God, that your conviction is sweet and it is kind and it is loving and corrective. It is a discipline from a loving Father. And we need to repent, some of us. We need to change. We need to get a new mindset, have a new understanding of what it is that you want for us individually. God, will you just come into our life? Will you forgive us for the times where we ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, where we lived and breathed justice, what is right and what is wrong? And will you help us once again eat from the tree of life that looks so much different? Will you help us keep you at the forefront, your glory at the forefront, your goodness at the forefront, your name at the forefront? Your love for us is far more important than anything we could ever want, far more important than anything we could ever desire in an earthly mindset. We forgive us for comparison. We forgive us for discontentment. We forgive us for choosing to be disgruntled. Will you give us wisdom in the days ahead on how it is that we're supposed to live and how it is that we're supposed to live life differently? In Jesus' name, amen. I ended a little early this morning. My message was a little shorter than usual because I kind of feel like after the final announcements, there are some folks who you might need some prayer this morning, and specifically some prayer around the idea of your work life. There's something going on at work right now, and you can't figure it out, and you need prayer for it. So I left a little bit of time at the end here for us to pray. We're going to invite the elders to come down, and they'll just be standing across the front here, And there'll be an opportunity for them to pray with anybody who's maybe struggling at work right now. We'll invite a few others to come down as well. If you're passionate about prayer, come down and pray for some people who'll be in need.